the feeling that I had when I came back is what they don't do now. You know, from Afghanistan there, and all that, it's quite a thing to overcome. And, well, like I said, I had a job, and I had a wife and family, and I had everything that only my memories. And I heard something on TV the other day that said that your mind controls your body, and if you don't think of that, just take a lemon, put it in your mouth and bite it, and your body feels it all through the body. Why? Because the mind does. And that's why that the mind puts you in a position of what you feel like. And if you could only just forget it, but you never forget it.
Is that why you rather not talk about your service days?
I feel terrible.
And it was almost 70 years ago.
Yeah.
Does it ever go away, do you think?
I don't think so. At least I, you know, like I don't think of it all the time, but I do think of it. And like when I joined the Air Force Club, well, there was 100 and some people over there, all veterans, all Air Force veterans. And you could, you know, you could work a conversation up to do something about it, you know. But now I'm the only one left.
This video, although it was shot in Ontario, right, could have easily been done in Newfoundland, Nova Scotia, in Quebec, it could have been done in Alberta, no. Saskatchewan, BC, any province. You could have gotten 5 or 6 individuals to tell almost the exact same stories in their unique perspective.
Mm-hmm.
And every single one of them, if you'll notice, and I've noticed this in my entire career as an MP, every single one of them, when they talk about their recruiting days, the beginning of their military career, they almost smile. You can almost see that, like that one gentleman who talked about those kids killed, his eyes are dead. You could see that.
Yeah.
But when he spoke about the recruiting time, they lit up just ever so slightly. So you could tell that in the beginning, they were very proud. They were very proud. And one of the saddest things I ever heard years ago was when a military guy told me the greatest day of his life, the proudest day of his life is when he put on the uniform. The happiest day is when he took it off. And I just think, oh my God, how can that be? But you hear it.
I was a happy-go-lucky kid. Later on, when I was a teenager, I started working on ambulances. Eventually, I worked on an ambulance from my home. And I got tired of that, and I decided to join the armed forces for a career.
Both my father and mother were in the army during the World War II, and my uncles too. When I was at the recruit center in Quebec City, they offered me a job there. I said, no, I want to help people. I want to be a medic.
I was unemployment. And a chance to see the world and help. And
part of our family traditions is when at certain times of year, like Thanksgiving and Christmas time, we, you know, the meals would be put on. And I was always interested in cooking. I signed up in the military after looking for work for a while, and I became a cook in the military.
What made me join the service was I joined in 1940, and I said, I'm not going to be called up. I'm going to leave before they call me up and make me go.
Driving down Main Street looking for the pub, and we passed the recruiting center. And I said to the guys, let's just go in and try. So we went in, and two of the three of us got into the military. And it was a start from there.
I was a typical
kid, teenager, that lived in Montreal. I was big time in sports. In 1975, I decided that I think I would like to join the military.
I've always been a military brat, as we're referred to. Always lived in PMQs, always lived on base. Growing up, my dad was my idol. So I was more than delighted to sign up for the military to follow in his footsteps.
I really didn't get into sports or anything like that. When I was growing up, I used to always say sports was for the jocks. They give you like three choices when you apply. And I wrote military police, military police, military police.
My dad was in the military too. Just seeing him growing up, you know, just being fit and being healthy and disciplined, kind of like pushed me to go in the military. I went at the mall and there was a display where they had, a military Jeep, and there was a girl there at the time, and I didn't know that, but it was a warrant. And she was recruiting for the reserves.
So they called, you want to be a welder? Okay, but there'll be a long wait. So, but hey, what about this job here? Did you ever think of being a field engineer? Field engineer, what's that?
The sergeant walked in the room. You work with computers or play with them? Yeah, good. You're our computer expert.
I had the chance to go into the instrument electrical 551 trade. And it was on aircraft, bearing from fighter jets to helicopters to trainers, cargo aircraft. I did them all.
I joined the Airborne Regiment, like I said, and I spent 7 years with them. And then I joined the military police. I did a career of 27 years with the military police.
The Airborne, that's something special. At first I was afraid of heights. But I was really proud of that, because when you wear the cherry beret, you just don't get it in a popcorn box. You earn that.
My husband was a supply tech, which means he wasn't on the front lines. He wasn't walking where there could be IEDs. He wasn't facing the roadblocks and stuff like that. And I'm not minimizing his role. I mean, supply is very important to the military.
Basically, you took everything off. Completely gutted the aircraft, and you renewed and replenished, like with new items or refurbished items, and basically it made the aircraft life like 10 years longer or so. Mm-hmm. So that's where I started.
Well, when I was 15 or 16 years old, when I was in Sea Cadets, I was sexually assaulted by a male officer at the corner, and on numerous occasions, and he had power and control over me. He was in many ways, and being an officer and all, looking up to the military being such a big thing in my life, and being young and impressionable, this officer got his claws in me that way, and just started slowing down in boot camp, and I really don't know what brought that on. Later on in life, I was diagnosed with a thyroid disorder. And now, as I look back upon things, that could have been the first time that my thyroid really took a big dip. And I became my superiors and people around me started pushing me harder. I didn't appear to be too on the ball. It's not the type of career that you can say, oh, I'm tired today, I can't go to work, or it's not like you can, you know, take off your hat and say I quit and then go home. You're the people around you is that your own rank is that you become a victim of a harassment and people being mean to you and hitting you and kicking you in some cases. And on one base, I had two instances. I had one fellow that came after me with a knife, and I just backed up and took off. And it's he followed me. It wasn't like there's screaming and yelling going on or anything like that. It was pretty scary. On one occasion, I had a knock upon my door, but somebody wanted to have it out with me, and you know, we went into the laundry room, and he started repeatedly punching me, and this fella had rank over me, and the barrack block NCO came by and saw him assaulting me, and he was up on charges, and shortly after that charge, I spent 2 months in Armed Forces Hospital.
As a military police, I had to deal with various gruesome stuff. You see murders, you see suicides, rapes, assaults. That was a little hard, but it was part of my job. I was a military police. I knew I had to investigate all this. I knew it was gross. However, it was part of my day-to-day job. However, when I went to Haiti, you see atrocities that you don't expect to see. With that came counting the bodies at the morgue, at the hospital morgue. If you picture yourself being in a room 10 by 10 at 120 degrees, 120 Fahrenheit, full of flies, not refrigerated, and it's 100 bodies in there. There were bodies there, they were decayed for months. They were there for 3 months, and it was very difficult.
Sergeant comes in our dorm, and there was three of us standing there, and he says, I need three volunteers, and he saw the three of us, and he says, you, and you, come with me. So we walked over into his office. Being that I was the last guy in the office, I started looking at the papers. I mean, looking at it, and I said, Sergeant, I don't want to go. I'm not going, because you're going to be doing something to me that I don't like. Well, he says, it's too late. I said, no, it's not. I don't want to go. Well, he says, I'm ordering you. You're going. We got to Suffield. And we were taken one by one, different places. And I was brought to this wooden slab-like table. And once they sat me and laid me down on the table, four guys come out, strapped my legs and my chest. I couldn't move if I tried. And this other guy at the same time put a rubber mask on my face, and there was some stuff there, and I didn't like the smell of it. But he said, count from 100 to 1 backwards. And I said 100, I never got to say 99, I was out. That was the scary part, the feeling. I thought, oh, here comes the worst of it. I saw this clock, it was 8:45. And when I woke up, they woke me up, the first thing I could see was the clock, and it was 2:45. They did this 2 days later. On the 25th of January, 1966, and on the 27th, 1966. I'm sure, I'm 99.9% sure, it was a nerve gas that they used to put me out.
I went basically on my second tour. It was in Kandahar. I worked up for it. I was force protection. I manned the checkpoint. It's rough. It's every day is like, you monitor thousands of Afghan because they come through your checkpoint. You're just waiting for maybe, like a suicide bomber, or the biggest threat is a vehicle bomb of any type, you know what I mean? Is a vehicle IED, that's like the biggest threat, because it's not just going to take. Well, the way we were set up, it would have probably, maybe killed, a dozen men just right off of the bat, right? And then there's always, I think the medical emergencies that are pretty gruesome. At first, it's a shock. After a while, it's like, you're kind of burnt because you're alert. You have to stay alert all the time. And then you expect, so I'm going to get sleep, but then rockets land that night, and it might be every night for 30 days. You don't know when it's going to end, so you never get sleep. There is no day off. There's never any day off. It's 12-hour shifts every day for whatever long you're there. If it's 8 months, you're doing that for 8 months.
Okay, if I look back in July 1974, on Friday at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, I was not prepared for it to see what I saw that day. I was a young medic at the base hospital who received a call that a grenade exploded. The first thing with everybody when I was in the office there, we thought that was on the grenade range. But it wasn't that. It was the call came from the cadet camp. So the ambulance came in, bringing the dead body of young kids and on the stretchers, and many more stretchers coming. They have to put all the stretchers along from the entrance to the emergency room because there was so many people, so yelling, so screaming. that was a captain was teaching some cadets in the closed room, in a wooden barrack. There was one live grenade among the box. The live grenade was circulating among the cadet. One cadet asked the instructor, "Is it dangerous to play with it?" He said, "No, they are fake grenade." So the grenade, the one pulled the pin, and the grenade explodes, kill him, two on the side, four on the way to the hospital, and injure 50 or more cadets. I was waiting at the hospital for them. Mm. I was a young medic. The ambulance brought to us, but us, we have to look after them. Mm-hmm. But I could watch and hear all the screaming, the yelling, and a bit of panicking because we were not expecting so many injured at the same time. It's like, it was like a movie. We saw the body, dead body, people screaming, and the doctor operating in the emergency room because they have no time to bring the cadet to the operation room. The guy, the two young, were 14 and 15. One is, the name was Eric. And I remember he has his face blown off at that. It was very painful to see.
We're now setting the scene in former Yugoslavia, and I'm in a small place called Srebrenica. And Srebrenica was an area where a small pocket of Muslim people living in Srebrenica were surrounded by Serbs, an entire division of Serbs. Our job over there was as peacekeepers. Something you never do is to promise someone that they're going to be okay. I've learned that one the hard way. Because they were all worried when we were finished our tour and we're about to leave. These teenagers who I'd got to know for, not teenagers, and their family men as well. It's not only the teenagers that were showing up at the gates, family guys. And my first tour, I left there good. I did my job. I helped people. It's all good. Between a first and second tour, there's a gap of 2 years. So now I'm back in Canada. And it was a year after my tour in Canada that we start hearing stories on the news of mass graves being uncovered. The stories start leaking out of Srebrenica of the horrors and massacres that had occurred. So I'm listening to that and I'm thinking, oh my God, they're dead. They're finding dead people over there, mass graves. What, you know? The second tour was the worst ones because now I would see for myself the mass graves that were uncovered between my first and second tour. My promises were empty to these kids that, oh, you're going to be okay. After we leave, other people are going to show up here, UN peacekeepers, who will do the same as I did here. And all of us, you know, you're going to be okay. It's all good. So yeah, I took that upon myself as though I myself had shot them.
Yeah, I was stationed in England. And I had one through for a WAG. That was a wireless air gunner. Well, the only thing I can tell you is that if you have friends and they don't come back every night, or every morning rather, they don't come back every morning, it makes you feel pretty bad. And it gets so that you got no friends left at all.
We were deployed overseas in the Adriatic Sea. There was two boats of Albanian refugees had capsized, and we went to the rescue in amongst other ships. And it turned out that the most we could save was two male adults out of 40-some plus refugees that they got drowned. The most upsetting part in that one particular example was watching men, women, and children trying to be saved, hoping to be saved, waving, help me, help my children, women holding babies, young kids, men holding young kids. And we just couldn't help them. Watching them go down. The thing that hurts the most is why, out of 300 people, why couldn't we have a different system for that type of situation? I don't know what the resolution would be, but they could come up with a different system so that it would be just like plucking apples out of a water barrel. You just go in and save them.
I dealt with a few child pornography investigations, mostly for other agencies. That was stressful because you have to recover and review all the images, videos, things like that. And a lot of these pictures either would provoke a little bit of anger, sorrow, because what you're seeing is definitely not what you would consider approvable. I can't really get into the description of it, but what you can think will not be as bad as what it was.
I'm a proud lesbian, and I wasn't really aware that that's something that I had to hide when I joined, because that's what happened. You got kicked out, you got the boot, you got, you know, you either get out or you're getting a dishonorable discharge.
What did it mean to you when you thought about the possibility of having to leave the military at that point?
It meant the end of my life. That's the only thing I've ever truly had passion for. Like, I loved it so much. Sorry. I loved working on aircraft. I loved the smell of the jet fuel, like just hearing them. I also got top student on my TQ4s as well as 5s. My TQ5s, I got a BAMU accommodation award. I got top marks across Canada and Europe, so I was the top. I was very proud, and I was doing good work, and I just received my records a couple years ago, which I wasn't privy to before, but it said I was well beyond my years in terms of my knowledge and service time, and that I would be in for a very lucrative career and many promotions. But after the fact, it's too late now. So I was very young, and I was a virgin when I joined. And I wasn't, sure for sure whether I was gay or not. I was a virgin. And I went to go for my very first pap test, and I didn't know what to expect. Basically, I got in there, and it was a huge room, and it was just one male doctor. Sorry. He told me to take off all my clothes, so I did as I was told, like you do when you're a soldier. I was lying totally naked on a stainless steel table for what seemed like hours, and he just kept circling around me like a vulture, watching me. Looking at me. Back then I did have a nice body, not like today. He left me uncovered. And then he continued and he assaulted me. And I left destroyed. And I couldn't tell anyone. There was no one to tell. So I just put in for my release.
The army jocks, the tough guys, what we're trained to be more or less when we get out of recruiting. We're confident, we're jocks, we're bulletproof. So when someone talks about post-traumatic stress disorder at first, in the when this was first being talked about, well, we'd all be going, ah, what a wimp. The guy's weak, the weak link. And we'd mock, maybe not to him directly, but, you know, amongst ourselves, the jocks, oh, what a weak guy, blah, blah, blah. So I was much part of that, because this is what you're familiar with. You're surrounded in an environment where that's the order of the day.
After the person symptoms of trauma come out into the open, and his employer gets the military is aware of it, they are sometimes, these people are sometimes shunned, harassed, bullied, punished.
You're no longer going to go on that course. You're no longer going to go on you're not going to get promoted anymore. You're not going to go on the next tour, that kind of stuff. So you keep it to yourself.
We never had any psychological help. I tried to talk about it, but people say that, Denis, stop talking about it. It's going to go away. So after a few years, you don't talk about it. You keep that inside you.
After this incident happened, it was my job as a senior superintendent on board ship. I was called chief. And if my men had something to discuss, I would be there to discuss it with them. After this incident, I had quite a few of them come to me to discuss the incident. I had to counsel them, console them. But I had nobody to console me or counsel me while we were at sea. When we come back to shore, I tried talking to my immediate supervisor about the incident. He says, it's part of the job, get on with it. In other words, suck it up. That hurt. So I think from that time on, I started holding a lot of things in.
Well, you start feeling alone. You have your friends, and yeah, I understand they're your buddies and you're going on tour. There are other NCOs, whatever rank, you know, and they're your friends, but you can't confine to them because they're going on tour too. You know what I mean? So you can't confine about how you really feel.
Talking to this, I find that it's very difficult. You always got to be careful what you say to people so they don't think, hey, this guy is crazy.
I had people that were really treating me really nice for a while until they found I had a psychological problem, and they wouldn't talk to me anymore. And it's like, oh. And being ex-military, is that a lot of people are like, hide the knives, you know? So, you know, it's people just don't understand that this is a nice guy, and he's got a psychological problem. He wouldn't hurt you, he'd help you.
I was kind of laughed at. I was separated because they didn't understand what I was going through. I didn't know I had a mental health issue. They didn't know I had a mental health issue.
Any friends I thought I had all left me once I was diagnosed with depression. They don't understand it. they think it's something I should just be able to shake off just because I'm not missing an arm or a leg. Doesn't mean that I'm not hurting a lot or that I'm not in pain.
We are not allowed to cry. A soldier doesn't cry. A soldier was emotionless. That's why I was tough back in those days. If you try to talk about something, people won't listen to you.
Don't talk about it. Do your job. Take your lumps and, go have a few drinks with the guys the other night and laugh it off.
Boot camp. That's what they inject you with. It's a lot of pride, self-pride, and bulletproof notion. We're not bulletproof. We're human. We have emotions.
They discharged me because I was in Suffield. I'm going to put it bluntly. They discharged me. Nothing I could do. I was boxed in. Anxiety problems I've noticed in 1972 after I got out. I'd have to get down on my hands and knees, and I would just like a dog, like, I started learning things. I might go into the library to read up on what was inside me, what they'd done. I had no clue that until Pauline Jewett. Pauline Jewett said that in the House of Commons in front of the speaker. She said, "Mr. Speaker, what's going to happen to the soldiers that were faced with nerve gas in 1966 in Suffield?" She said that in 1988. And this is when my problems started getting worse. I was on the street. I was scared because I was starting to just trying to tell people what's going on, what happened over there in Suffield. And I was scared. Every time I seen a military vehicle or any personnel in the military, I'd go the opposite way and hide because people, I thought, well, maybe I know too much. Maybe I should shut up for a little while. So then I'd end up going to sleep in the park, sleeping in cars. This was going on for a whole year. I'd be sitting there sometimes on a park bench, just sit there and just cry for no reason. Sometimes the anxiety problem was so bad, you could hardly breathe. You can't breathe when you have an anxiety attack.
You're paranoid. I couldn't be in malls. I couldn't be around anybody. So pretty much for the first 2 months when I got back, I just stayed in my place and just drank steady around the friggin' clock. Like just kept drinking, and that was it, So you don't have to feel that pain,
I guess one of the classic things that both the individuals and their families will say is he's not the same person.
All those years, because we were married 17 years, and Kosovo was his last tour when he was with me. Now, when he came back from Kosovo, though, we really started to grow apart. And he really started to separate from me. Like if I would say, "What's wrong?" he'd say nothing. And then I never got to know. And once I realized that I can't get in, and I started, it started to affect me as a person. And I looked at my children and I thought, oh, I can't do this. I have to be strong for them and I have to be healthy. And these kids deserve to be in a healthy family, and this isn't healthy. And it's not going to get fixed. And he wouldn't let me help him, and I couldn't help him. And I just saw myself and the kids go down with them, and I thought, no, I can't do that to them. So that's when I decided to leave. He was diagnosed with PTSD, and he eventually was released from the military because of it. And it took 7 years for the military medical system to realize, okay, this is what's wrong with this guy.
I will say a good 10 years when I stopped working completely, semi-retired, that then I'm mowing the lawn, and as I walk behind my lawnmower, then I start thinking at all this. So my mind was running and racing and coming back with all these experiences that I had. I couldn't sleep. Even today, I'm on sleeping pills, antidepressant pills. I wake up in the middle of the night with sweating and talking to myself, and I get backflashes, I get flashes of what I seen, especially the worst atrocities that I seen in Haiti or as a patrolman.
And when you have a flashback, you go back to the world you're in, and you don't see what's around you in real life. You just see what was around you back then. You have all the same feelings, the adrenaline rush, and you panic.
I go to, for example, just an example, to a store where it's very crowded. I had to walk away. I start to sweat, start shaking. Yes, I used to be a person that crowds didn't bother me. Today, it's scares me. Now I'm more a, I will say, a house person.
I don't want to see anybody. Okay, I would draw just walking my dogs, try to act normal, but I knew I was not normal.
Our coping skills amount to trying to mask the pain. Yeah, that's how that affected me. I turned into a butterfly.
For a long time, I was a risk taker. I really didn't care what happened. So I'd drive flat out on the highway as fast as the bike could go and see how long I could do it. Things like that, see how fast I can take turns.
I got more and more angrier over time. I just felt resentful of everything going on around me. And when my wife would mention, "Mel, there's something wrong, go get checked," I would get even more peeved off at her. I would get mad at her. "There's nothing effing wrong with me. You go get yourself checked. You're the one that's making me mad." I lost my children because they were fed up. I lost two of my brothers because they were fed up. The person I feel the most sorry for is my wife, Brenda. She has went through hell.
Like if I was peeling a potato with a knife, he'd blow up at me. He said, "You got a carrot peeler? Peel it with a carrot peeler." And he'd blow up. And the worst was when he come home one night, he was so mad. He went downstairs, got one of his rifles. He says, "Where's my ammunition?" He wanted to kill himself. And I turn around and I told our son, when he went to the basement, I said, "Hide all the ammunition because I know what's coming." And to talk him down and talk him out of that was very hard to do.
Then it's time to go back to work. So you go back to work and you realize again that there's nothing here. There's nothing here. You're getting too used to it. Just like a guy in jail, he'll commit a crime just to go back into jail because he doesn't know any better. So to me, in my mind, it was just to go back on a third tour, and that's it. That's what I did. Let's go back on a third tour. You're always there. You're always in Afghanistan. You're always on exercise, even when you're not. How can I explain it? It's like if I was going to play heavy metal, but it's in your head 24 hours a day for forever. You know, eventually you start going kind of nuts.
Suicide was always in my mind. Finally, I was, after 4 months, I was diagnosed with post-traumatic disorder, PTSD.
I called Saint-Anne de Bellevue Hospital. It takes about eight months before I saw a psychiatrist. If I didn't receive any help there, I was going to shoot me or kill me.
By the time you get aware, I think a lot of post-traumatic stress disorder, before they become aware, it's because they hit bottom. Something happened.
One night, my wife and I were sitting in front of the computer just watching a movie. Something in the movie triggered a flashback.
And all of a sudden, he started to shake. He went crazy. And when he come to, he had me up against the wall with his hands around my neck.
That's when I come through. I looked at her. I said, what just happened? She says, "I don't know." She broke down crying.
It scared him to death when he did that. It scared me to death because he's never laid a hand on me.
I apologized profusely, and I went downstairs, cried, and contacted veterans for help. That's when I first realized, yes, there is something wrong.
I was ready to kill myself. I had drank a bottle of Southern Comfort, and I was about to take the sleep aid pills when a song came on the video channel, because I always had music playing around me. And it made me think about my wife, and it stopped me. So I called the helpline and told them what was going on, and they started dealing with it. I was diagnosed with post-traumatic stress disorder, OCD, and major depression.
Not going to explain what the breakdown is, but you just break down, and they say, well, you know, you're not going on this friggin' tour, you have an issue, and that's it. So then you don't go. Mia was at the Warrior Center. You should stay here. We're going to take care of you here. You can stay here until you're better. You know what I mean? Then I see my CO from the regiment, you know, that I was from, and he offered me a position back at my armories. He said, you'll get the help that you should through Ottawa. And, you know, and so I put my trust in what this individual was saying. Believe it or not, the tempo picked up, and I was gone every weekend. I had exercised with the courses. It was brutal. Well, the tempo, what they should have did, what, and you ask anybody, and I'm sure even you would agree to this, is that when a person breaks down, it's time for him to take a break. But the problem is in the reserves is that they're not monitored. Things just got drastically worse. Like, I was in mental institution, like almost I would say on a monthly basis. I got a DUI, I was getting arrested all the time, to the point where you're like broke, I don't know, you're going to trial, you're fucking just completely trashed every weekend. It's like, and still nobody is reacting. As long as you're going to work and doing your job and doing what they say, they're just kind of like, lax, and they're posing themselves as help, and it's not. At some point in all this, my CO decided that, you know what, I've had enough. We're gonna have to part ways now. It was kind of illegal what he did, but he got away with it. Basically, I was like, I couldn't work. I had no money. I was going through trial. I was a year and a half, 2 years passed, you know. That's the amount of time that I lost pay, and through all that, there was no help.
It's going away, but it's still quite prevalent that the military will think, oh, you're an MIR commando, you're always going to the infirmary, mental illness isn't real. Why aren't you better yet? Or, you know, you're faking it, or all sorts of different things. There are a lot of people who are knowledgeable and know that that's not the case. Mental illness, you don't see the disease.
When I would recommend that, you know, people I had diagnosed with post-traumatic stress disorder be removed from the military environment and placed in calm environments away from all military stimuli, so that as soon as possible after I diagnosed them. Unfortunately, most of these people were forced to remain within military environments for months and up to a year. The fact that they were still in a military environment full of triggers for re-experiencing the traumatic feelings meant that it was completely impossible to do trauma therapy. We spent all of our time helping them to cope with the everyday reminders because they were expected to remain, to snap out of it or to bounce back without being actually taken out of the military environment. And in my opinion, a lot of damage was done to many of the active duty people I worked with as a result of that.
We thought we were just having marriage problems. we never realized that, okay, maybe there's mental health issues here, maybe there's PTSD involved, maybe that never even crossed our mind. It shouldn't have been our responsibility. Like, the military knew at that point everything that we were going through. We should have received a phone call or you know, 2 or 3 weeks after a tour saying, how are things going? And then we could have maybe identified. But then maybe if we would have got the phone call, we would have just said, fine. For that stigma reason, I don't know. The phone call never came.
Our friend Jacques over here was telling us a story about how that they use them as a guinea pig, okay? And I always said in my mind, the military has never done that to me. I served 27 years in the military. There's no way the military will do such a thing like this. However, one day I got on the internet and I got a full document over here, and I pinpointed the regiment that Jacques was on it. I came and talked to Jacques, and I apologized to Jacques. I said, I had doubts on you, but I don't have any more doubts. And I believe that the military is not telling you everything they do. Not at all.
Yeah, I do have post-traumatic stress from Afghanistan, but I think about what the military did to me, and it's unbelievable. You took an individual and you threw him in the trash. You got rid of him. You made him disappear. My release came through and the military decided to release me medically. I met with this girl and she's like, do you realize that you have benefits, that you have, you know, it's like reserve benefits, and, you know,
Veterans Affairs takes care of the veterans. It's sort of like unemployment insurance, I would say, for veterans. If you're injured, they help you with the medical costs. Because I have mental illness things, they pay for my medication. They pay for my psychiatric visits. They pay for all the stuff that anything like OHIP wouldn't cover. They cover all that sort of stuff. They used to have a pension system which was by far superior to this than this award system that they have on, because the award is basically 7 years pension given to you in one lump sum. And I hate to say this, but most people, when they're given a lump sum, will spend it. If they're depressed and all messed up at the time, they have a tendency of spending it, maybe on drugs, booze, and then they're broke after maybe a year or two, and they have nothing more to live with. While when you're on the pension, you had the pension for the rest of your life. You were safe. And I honestly think that was a pure cost-cutting move by the government of the day.
There are some parts of the charter, like the lump sum payment, which ends up being proven that it's actually a saving to government and not to the individual. So if you're 59 years old and you're injured out of the military, a lump sum may be a good thing. But if you're 22 years old, a lump sum is a disastrous thing to receive. The new Veterans Charter, although flawed, does have some good aspects to it. We simply won't deny that. But the biggest problem is these problems didn't exist since 2006, although they've been severely compounded since then, especially with the Afghan mission. These problems have been around for a long, long time. I'm dealing with cases from the 60s, 70s, the 80s, and 90s, long before the Veterans Charter, because now what's happening with the stories in the media about veterans issues, more and more veterans are coming forward and said, well, I had a case 20 years ago that I never dealt with. Can you help me reopen it?
Yes. You know, finally, we've got these guys to come forward and say, I've got a problem. I'm coming clean. I've got issues. I need help. Now, all of a sudden, it's prove-it time. And prove-it time's not easy, right? You know, because, oh, well, you know, we have to attribute this to service. So
they tried to pin everything on my childhood. I was a perfectly happy child. None of this is from my childhood. This is directly related to my service.
We have to get all your files, and you have to do the access to information to get all those files to make your case, right? The system these guys are facing is adversarial. They've got the, oh, you got to have this, you got to have that.
Give a little leniency to the individual as far as documents pertaining to the incident. In some cases, the young corporal, the young private, the young master corporal associated with Afghanistan is going to end up with PTSD at one time or another, whether they have it now or, like in my case, if they suck it up, it's going to break eventually. then 16 years down the road, 15, would these people have the documentation? Would they have the ability to acquire this documentation? It's a hard process left on the individual in trying to seek help. So when I applied to Veterans, I didn't submit this document. I got rejected. Then I had to start the process basically over again. So as of now, it's been a year and 9 months since the start of my claim to Veterans.
First of all, you just said it yourself. To come forward and admit you have a problem. That's step one. Mm-hmm. Step two is finding the right people to listen to your concern and be able to point you in the right direction to get the help you need. Step three should be the immediacy of that help, whether it's prescription drugs, whether it's rehabilitation. A year and 9 months and he's still on it? That's insane.
My file was sent to one place, to one place, to one place, to one place. We find out after that. And I was denied. Because even if I had a psychologic report and a psychiatrist report, the board over there, they said, oh, we're sorry. We can do nothing for you.
He witnessed an event of children being killed, cadets being killed by a grenade.
Yeah.
You don't need a psychiatric report to know that maybe there's something wrong here. What is it that you need that we can help you with? But no, you got to fill out this document. And then they denied. Whatever issue they're facing, this compounds that problem.
Mm-hmm. You're waiting to get your benefits and you're trying to fill out the paperwork and they're denying you, they're stalling it. Then you start to think, well, maybe it is me. This is all my fault.
Yes.
What have I done wrong?
They're not ignorant to the point where they don't know what they're doing. They're doing this because of the no-go policy. Mm-hmm. If they say no long enough, you'll go away. You know, and the 3D policy, which I've already witnessed, delay, deny, then die.
When I call the Veterans Affair and ask them to see my psychiatrist in Saint-Anne-de-Bellevue, if they will have answered deny me, I will have killed myself because I was not able to sleep anymore. I was anger. I had nightmare. I was not feeling right. So. I cry for help. That's what I want. That's what I was. I'm lucky I got it. Because I wouldn't be here to talk about it.
But one of the things that really disturbs me, the end of the reason is when people say, well, why is this happening? Money. It's only about money.
Everybody that I meet is in shock. They're all like, oh my God, you know, like that's horrible to do to a veteran. You know, and they're like, oh, well, you know, I guess you fell through the cracks. And the only thing going through my mind is how do you fall through the cracks? I'm a person. I'm not a set of keys. I'm not an inanimate object. I'm a person. You fell through the crack. I did two fucking tours in Afghanistan. I'm a war veteran. I fell through the cracks. Hey, you fell through the cracks. Ha ha, we got away with 2 years pay. We saved 2 years on this veteran's back. Ha ha ha. That's, seriously, it's like, what the fuck? What kind of psychotic fucking organization do we have in Ottawa? How insane is that?
You know, they're willing to spend huge amount of dollars on machinery. You know, for battle, when you become discharged and you have a medical issue, is that they nickel and dime you.
But no government policy should ever shortchange a military veteran and their family ever.
If I'm in Afghanistan and I'm patrolling, whatever, and I leave a troop behind and I go back into the camp and they're like, hey, you have a troop missing, you know. Am I allowed to turn to that commander and say, oh, well, he must have fell through the cracks. Ha ha ha, I guess he fell through the cracks. Okay, troops, that's it. Oh, well, whatever. He's in town there or whatever. I don't know. I'm going to bed. But that's what they did to me.
The support I'm getting from one individual in Veterans, she has been a super lady for me. She constantly calls, making sure that things are progressing okay, checking up on my health.
Is this your case manager?
That's my case manager, yes. Mm-hmm. She's a wonderful lady. She cares.
Many of my clients express concern about the fact that case managers have been cut, and so my clients depend heavily on their relationships with their case managers. The case managers are generally great and want to do a good job, but you know, if your caseload is too big, then the quality of support for veterans is definitely affected.
I am better looked after now than I was when I came on the service. Now they send down somebody from the veterans to interview me last week, and they asked me what I needed. You know, I mean, they've been really good to me. They gave me my pension, and I'm on the VIP program, and I know they're not as doing as well with the new guys coming out. I know that.
Two, there's mental health associations. It's not enough. We need more. When you're waiting 6 months to see a psychologist, during that 6 months, this person is suffering from a disorder that is could be death or life.
Robbie, which was my oldest, he was a pretty average kid. I mean, you know, his grades in schools were good. He worked part-time at McDonald's, and he was doing good there, and he had lots of friends. And at 16, he started talking about joining the Army. But Robbie was a very sensitive, very introvert young individual, and I questioned that choice, not to him, but in my mind. So I convinced him to join the reserves. And I said, why don't you go that route? Because like we said earlier, it's a lifestyle choice. It's not just a job. So I said, join the reserves, see if you like it. If you don't like it, you know, learning experience, choose something else. But if you like it, then you know it's the right choice for you. And he agreed. And so he joined the reserve as soon as he turned 17. And he loved it. And not only did he just love it, he excelled at it. He graduated top of his basic training course. He had a bright future in the military. And we were told that he had everything it took to make it. So that was, he graduated his basic training in June of 2010. In October of 2010, he admitted thinking of committing suicide. And I thought, well, that's odd. So we came to the hospital, and they recommended that he see a psychologist right away, or psychiatrist, sorry, right away, to see what was going on. And so they referred us on an emergency basis to a psychiatrist. And unfortunately, that meant a week on an emergency basis. So we got in to see the psychiatrist, who sat with Robbie for a short period of time and said that he felt that Robbie was suffering from depression, and that he should have some counseling to get to the roots of it, to figure out what's causing the depression and so forth. And he was put on medication, and it just went downhill from there. So that was in October of 2010. And our trip to hell began that day. In August 19 at 3:00 in the morning, I get a call from the Nova Scotia RCMP saying that my son had passed away, and that he had committed suicide. When I say the road to hell is because we couldn't find appropriate support. We didn't know where to look. So that's the main reason. And then the other reason is, even once we started figuring out where to look, we couldn't find it. It just wasn't there. And I'm not saying any names and I'm not blaming anybody. I mean, the system is so overloaded and underfunded, everybody's in the same boat. And that has to change.
Mental health services are definitely a part of a larger medical system, and that system sometimes isn't listening. Psychological services are understaffed. Part of the reason for that is that there's incentives missing. But I'd like to, you know, finish with a couple of points that I think could help this situation. In Cornwall, there are a number of veterans who are helping themselves by establishing their own support network.
We are Friends of Vets. We started about 8 months ago, and to provide peer-to-peer support for veterans and their families.
Well, I want to talk to both of you, the two newcomers today.
Yeah.
We're here to help you guys. So we don't know everything, but if we can help in one way or another, we will.
And the friends that I'm with now, the Friends of Vets, this is the greatest thing that ever happened. And I hope more of the guys get off the street because of that.
I think that the cities, the provinces, the country should think at establishing more groups, support groups for these people and their family members. They suffer from the same trauma that you're suffering. Maybe not to the point that they've seen the atrocities or they've seen the problems, but by you suffering, they suffer.
If your child is diagnosed with cancer, there's a path there. There's been so much research. There's so many resources. There's so many support systems in place. So there's a path to follow from the diagnosis to the, okay, now this has to happen and this has to happen and this has to happen. Sometimes it's successful and, you know, God bless that. And unfortunately, sometimes it's not. But at least as a parent, you have a roadmap. When your child is diagnosed with a mental health illness, there's no roadmap.
I think a lot of therapy will be required.
It's good, very good therapy, very good. You know, I'm really, really happy that I met up with a doc. At first, it was scary because hey, there's things that you gotta close the door on, and then there's, well, I opened it, and I'm glad I did now because it's helping me heal a lot better.
So breaking the silence, yeah, it's hard to get through that barrier. But I'm glad I'm through that barrier. I become more relaxed. I become more open to what was inside me that I had to get out.
I take more pills than you can shake. I'm on three different antidepressants just each day, one in the morning, one at supper time, and one before I go to bed.
In AA, they, you know, yeah, let go, let God, let Him take over. I surrender, I give up. That helped as well.
Well, if you look back in 1974 when that thing happened, there was no help offered. Now I know, like my psychiatrist told me, he said, when you suffer from PTSD and you hide it for so many years, it takes much longer to cure.
It will be easy to say, go back to be extremely busy and not think about all this. But again, this is only a camouflage type, temporary camouflage. Sooner or later, you're going to have to come out of that camouflage.
Mental illness takes longer than most other things to heal. People don't see it. However, after a certain amount of time, people go, why aren't you better yet? And that frustrates me.
It's going to take years if it can be cured at all. I think it'll always be there in the back of your mind. I'm in for the long haul with this. And that's what scares me the most.
It took me a long time to get over it. Matter of fact, I'm not over it yet. I still feel something's the matter, you know. But That's where I guess that's the way it goes.
I'm not quite like the way I was way back, but I'm slowly getting there.
Because he's not the man I married, but I love him just the same.
Trauma is a transformative experience. You're not the same person after that the traumatic event. And I would say probably never will be the same person.
You talk to your mother. She put things there like, well, Jacques, she said, if you have a problem, just think about it as another normal day. Mom, what's normal? Everyday life? That's what it is, she said. That was the best thing she told me. She said, just think of it as another day. Okay. But that really counseled me there. That was really, really helpful. I said, geez, I'll go to bingo and see what happens at the bingo hall. I met her, my wife, at the bingo hall. Never forget that day. I'll never regret it. The best thing in my life right there. Right? She's my rock and my post to lean on. She's everything.
Life is life, and it's your life. And you live it to the best of your ability. And don't judge yourself. That's not your fault. It's maybe the government's fault, maybe somebody else's fault, but it sure as hell not his fault or your fault.
Right now, my hopes and dreams is just to leave, is just to start a new life. But I have to resolve this, though. I have to resolve everything that's been going on with the military, with the release, with everything else. I have to resolve this. It's got to be put behind me. I need closure. And then at least now I can look at my medals and say, oh, well, you know, I remember when I was in the Army. Right now, the only thing I can remember is how they ruined my life.
How have you kept yourself going all this time? I mean,
with this kind of... My dog and the fact that my parents are living are why I'm still here. I promised my parents I wouldn't hurt myself. So that's why I'm here, to be quite honest. All bets are off once they're gone.
I'm actually ashamed to have post-traumatic stress disorder from my tour, because my tour is nothing like the ones that are happening today. So there's this feeling of shame. How dare I have post-traumatic stress disorder?
There's no way to understand. I don't understand what the guys in World War II went through. The guys that were before me probably went to Bosnia or Haiti, right? I don't understand what they went through. They don't understand what the guys in World War II went through, you know? I see World War II footage and I'm like, wow. Because you look at like the concentration camps, it's, you know, I can't even imagine that. You know what I mean? So everybody's war is different.
Well, they're the same principles. The same... You either get shot or you shoot somebody else. The only thing I can say is that those people who gave their lives shouldn't have to give their lives. We should have a different way of settling something, a dispute. The people that are head of a country, they want the war, but the ordinary people, most of them don't want it.
Well, for me, the military was a big challenge. I loved the challenge. I wanted to jump out of a plane. I did jump out of a plane. I learned a great deal out of the military. My recommendation, it's... Everybody should go through the military for the experience, if it's not for anything else.
Sometimes folks ask me, you know, why are you so angry? Why are you so angry? And I'm like, I'm 38. I have nothing. I lost everything. My dreams before Afghanistan were to buy a house, meet a girl, I don't know, have kids. Now it's like, it's pay to pay, you know? It's like everything's gone. Pretty much my freedom, I'm a criminal, you know what I mean? And I know this for a fact, is that I'm not the only guy that's back from Afghanistan, because I have friends that are in the exact same boat.
PTSD, I don't think it really just for military, because if you look at a firefighter or paramedic, they some of them, they suffer PTSD too. It's not, I don't think it's just a military related thing, because the paramedic, if you go to an accident and you saw a young baby dead, I'm pretty sure it's going to be affected by PTSD. But in the army, you're more prone, because if you go in combat zone or something like that, or you deal with ammunition, that there is always danger. To be faced with that tragedy.
There are big waves of layoffs coming up, and everybody knows that. So now all these military members who are getting laid off, either voluntarily or because they have to, are going to end up back in their communities. And some of these people are from little tiny villages in Newfoundland, and they're going to end up back home. And all these issues aren't going to go away. They're going to go home with them. Sort of like when Robbie came out of Chio to nothing. These people are going to come out of that environment to nothing.
When you have PTSD, you feel isolated. So I think if we can prevent to somebody to be isolated and commit suicide, I think that's my goal.
Well, I wanted to do this so that women do have a voice. The women that went through the things that I did. And I hope to God that the military is treating the women that they have now far better than what they did.
After they're psychologically damaged, as we see in the newspapers, people not being... treated respectfully and getting the treatments that they need in a timely fashion. These people feel tremendously betrayed by their countries and by their chains of command. Anger is a very frequent feeling of these people.
Because they're turning their heads away from us. Why don't they just look at us and explain to us and say, hey, we're here to help. Are you really helping us? Are you really going to help us? Come on, guys, wake up. Help us. Look at us. We're veterans. We did something for our country. We signed a line. We were prepared to die for our country. Not like this.
You need to take care of who signed their line on the dotted line and said, if I have to, I'll give you my life. You put the life on the dotted line. And people had this stuff happen to them. Now take care of them. Honor what you owe them.
I think in real life is that if you want result, you have to take that into your own hands. You know, so it's better to just inform the citizens, you know, and make them aware of what's going on. And then as a mass, you can push over any pillar. There's no pillar. As a nation, you can undo whatever was done. There's nothing that can stand in our ways. Canadians don't understand that anymore, all right? A person that's gone to war understands that, is that there's no pillar, there's nothing there that can't be done. These windows have kept me close enough, still shy.